G'day and welcome to the 26th episode of the Destiny Down Under podcast. This week we talk to BlueCrew from Focus Fire Chat, we cover off on all the latest Destiny news, and we answer a few lore questions while we're at it. It's a good one, stick around. Cheers. What's cracking, everybody? Welcome to the 26th episode of the Destiny Down Under podcast. I am Log Power Slave, and I am joined, as always, by my lovable co-hosts, Merlin Games and Deranged Sloth. And we're joined this week by none other than Blue from the Focus Fire Chat. How are we, dudes? What's going on?
What's cracking?
You deserved that.
Oh, God. You know, if anyone doesn't have any context, that's going to be just like, what is this? Instant leave, instant unfollow, instant banned. I shouldn't be. By the way, Blue, I don't know if you've tuned into previous podcasts, but you often lose subscribers being here.
We need to get that disclaimer podcast. Off the bat.
It's one of our best traits.
That's the test of true podcasting, right?
Yeah.
Can you gain followers? How many can you can chase away?
Yeah. It's about the passion, really. It's really about the passion. Right. If you can passionately inspire people to unfollow, you're doing something right.
All right, on the note of explaining why the intro is so awful this week, first up, congratulations to the man immediately to my left. That looks like my arm's chopped off, but anyway. 100,000 subs on YouTube this past week, well, a little bit over a week ago. We haven't Thank had you. An episode since. So, good one.
Thank man. You.
Congratulations. But to explain the terrible intro, Mylan put up a video. Get on his channel and watch it. It's him watching some of the first stuff he ever did for YouTube. And
yeah.
I mean,
he's average.
I think it's am I the only person who wishes Mylan was still talking about boners within the first 30 seconds of a video? Like, I really feel you missed the demographic there, man. I think I might have to take up the mantle of the boner lore driven.
Look, it was a hard time in my life. I was experimenting. You just got to keep cracking at it. It was my 100th video was when I finally realized not to say that kind of stuff.
Seriously?
Yeah.
100 videos in.
Yeah.
Don't talk about dicks.
Yeah, I have 100 videos on private before I realized I'm doing something wrong. This is not how to YouTube.
Well, I don't have much hope then, because I thought it was fucking great. Anyway. Wow. Okay. That's very cheeky. Very cheeky. But, I mean, that's our big news for the week on a personal front. So, congrats, Matt. Like, seriously, well-deserved. I know how much you put into it. It's a huge undertaking, and it couldn't have happened to a better bloke. So, on you, mate.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. If we can continue the circle, Jerk, thank you for getting me nominated for Movie of the Week, for the community focus. I got noticed by Cosmo.
Yeah, well, that was... I mean, I haven't used creative writing like that since in high school. So, mate, it was like... I'm actually thinking I could go into politics with the amount of, like, bullshit in that post. Again, dude, it couldn't go to a more deserving bloke if it did happen. But, you know, let's not hold our breath. We've got the Cosmo noticed. We'll add you to the list 5 years later.
Yeah, that's probably my
5 years later.
So, beyond that, how are we, dudes? What's been happening? How's your week been? Or 2 weeks? We had a week off. I actually died of KFC and rose again last Sunday.
Was that an intentional Easter joke, or was that...
Well, it was. I mean, I kind of realised that I could make the most of it, given I ended last podcast eating KFC, and if anything's going to kill me, it's that.
Oh, yeah, that's true. That's true. I won't talk anymore. What are you up to, Sloth? What's been your week like?
Yeah, it's been all right. Doing the raid thingies and all that sort of thing. Got one or two done on stream, got a few done off stream. It's been pretty good, man. I just made the mistake of eating something that had ghost chilies in it yesterday, and I had to cancel my Taco Fridays last night. So,
ghost chili.
Pretty much the hottest chili in the world.
Why is it called ghost chili? Because it kills you.
Yes.
You just become Casper.
I had a very sore stomach last night. And I won't go into the other details, but just you can use your
imagination. Oh, please. Why didn't you like set up your stream rig and just put a green screen behind the shitter and just
just the Outback toilet in the background?
Dude, you did Taco Fridays anyway. People should be expecting that kind of shit.
Yeah.
Wow. Anyway, Blue, how are you? Welcome to our humble little stream of bullshit. How are you? Hey. What have you been up to? What's been going on?
Just mostly trying to survive the week. We're getting ready for a pretty full weekend on our side. So we'll be doing the normal Focus Fire podcast pretty much immediately after this at 10 or 10 our time. And then next or tomorrow, we're doing a stream with the Dames. So we'll be talking some more lore on Saturday around noon Central.
Nice. Not to work out what time that is for us, but I'm pretty sure it's very early.
It is a time that happens in the near future.
Okay.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Because you're about 14 hours ahead, I think.
Yeah, we are from the future.
Yeah.
The other thing that we do for all of our guests here on the DDU podcast is we actually send you the lotto numbers from the future. So you also become a millionaire. So we'll do that.
Nice. All right,
on that note, dude, please, Blue, if you could introduce yourself and explain to our humble listeners who you are, what you do, and that sort of stuff.
Okay. Well, I'm BlueCrew 86. I'm the founder and the host of Focus Fire Chat, which is basically a Destiny lore podcast. We do a lot of exploring in Destiny and then other games as well. We do a monthly, what we call extra lore, which is where we go out and we look at other games that the community has, you know, is playing right now. This month we're doing D&D, for example. We're talking about the Forgotten Realms. And so we do that every month. And then we'll do the normal podcast is every week. And that is actually determined by the community. So what we do is every weekend, which is like right now it's going on, we throw up a poll over on Twitter and we let people vote about what they want us to talk about. And we put it into chat on Tuesday on, you know, Destiny Reset, kicks it off. And then that runs for a week. And then every Friday we get together with our team and stream a recap of that conversation, basically. So it's basically our podcast, I guess you would say, is just really a recap of what the community is talking about for that particular topic. It's really fun. It gets a little crazy.
Have you done any lore on the Warhammer 40K side?
We have a group that is talking about Warhammer. I know nothing about Warhammer, but it's
look at
it's Sloth. Very.
Look at him.
For those just listening, for those
never
just
see a sloth just this
listening,
animated in the wild.
Sloth is masturbating furiously right now. If you are just listening to the audio version, it is. We might have to end the stream there, I think.
We're done. Done. All right.
I think it's an incredibly novel way.
I've accomplished my mission.
I think it's an incredibly novel way of both getting your audience included in what you're doing and sort of making sure that you're answering the questions or covering the content they want answered to begin with. Yes. I mean, I've had a vote I'm not going to say every week, but I've hopped in and had a vote. Oh, yeah, that seems interesting. Like, so I think it's unreal. Have you ever sort of got to a point where you're like, oh, we really kind of didn't want to talk about that, but now we have to, because that'd got to be my fear.
Yeah. We actually, for the longest time, had an option on the poll called yes, because when we originally started, there was a large group of our community who refused to participate in a poll unless the option was yes, unless there was an option yes on it. And it was like every week, and then we had a couple people who started like seriously campaigning for the positivity of yes, and they finally won. I think, God, so it was so successful. We got it, and it was like we were sitting there behind, you know, the podcast team was like, "Crap, what are we talking about?" Like the first time it won. It's won twice. It's actually due to come back onto the poll next month, I think. But like, so it was just basically, all right, you guys talk about whatever you want during the week, and then when we do the podcast, we're going to surprise you. And so the first time around, it was storytelling and story crafting and like what our thoughts were on like how you can successfully make video games with story crafting. And then the second time we did kind of a, I actually had my wife jump onto the podcast and we did a an entire episode about being parents and being gamers. And
I thought that was going to go a completely different way then, to be honest.
And then that was when we got banned from Twitch.
Yeah, sometimes people are serious. Well, like, welcome to the DDU Blue, where we like to talk shit for about an hour and then have someone on who does something serious, like parenting or something.
You know
like
what?
That.
I'll promise you right now, Blue, I will do this in the spirit of Focus Fire Chat. I'm going to put a poll up for next week's episode. And it'll be, what do you want us to talk about? And every option will be dicks.
There you go, see?
You give, said a mouthful of water, you prick.
For the illusion of free will, right there.
Yeah, right, yeah. Yeah, I mean, you can choose. Your fate's the same, but you can still choose.
It doesn't matter what you do. You're still getting this.
That would be my concern, but I guess, I think it's an incredibly novel way of engaging your audience, so congratulations on the show and how well it's doing.
Very much so.
I'm not going to say I listen to every episode because I've got about 8 podcasts that I try and keep up with these days. Yeah. But I tune in when I can, and it's great. I mean, it's good. There's like a, you know, I think every podcast engenders its own little community. It has its own unique tone, and you're definitely on the money with that. You're onto something good, mate.
Thank you have you. Yes, really, and appreciate talking positive things, and we have phalluses.
They're kind of I don't have it.
It's not a trade-off I'm going to weigh in on. All right, so let's move on a little, shall we? There's not been a whole heap of news sort of over the last couple of weeks. We're in that lull between when we get the gameplay reveal and all of that. But I mean, since we've last been on, we've gone through both the King's Fall and the Wrath of the Machine challenge modes. How's everyone's experience with that? Did you get anything good? Did you find it fun? Mm. Sloth seems very excited.
I didn't even do King's Fall.
Me either.
I just skipped it. Yep. It was like it never happened.
Yeah.
No, you didn't. Did you skip it, Log? I thought we did it.
No, I did it. I didn't. I was in the party talking to you, and you were like, "Oh, we need one more." And I went, "Nope."
Yeah.
Like, if you've got a good team and not even a good team, if you've got your regular raid team and everyone's familiar, how long does King's Fall normally just take to do?
45.
Just with an average team that everyone knows.
No longer than an hour and a half, there or thereabouts.
So even if you know what's up, you know, let's just be at least an hour, more than an hour, right? So I don't know. I just find getting that amount of time and making it worth it is extremely tough, to be honest.
It's just, I was doing it with a friend of mine, a friend of ours, Log Sassy, the other day, and like he was just saying that, you know, they got all the way up to Oryx, and then him and his mates were like, "Do you want to do VOG? Because King's Fall is boring."
Yeah.
It's boring. Yeah. I'm not a fan of King's Fall at all.
But it's weird. It's got all the elements that would make it exciting. Like, why is it boring?
Yeah, like a giant wall of dicks.
Why?
Yeah, it's got a phallus wall and all. Well and good, but it's just boring.
Yeah, I sort of agree, but it should be good, right? Like, I don't know. I can't pin why I get bored of it too. What about you, Blue? Do you got inside there?
The whole thing with King's Fall, I'm in agreement. I'm just not interested in it. Like, I think I've run it maybe a handful of times. And it just was meh. Like,
yeah,
meh.
It's meh.
it's very meh. You've hit the nail on the head.
Well, and the problem with our, like, the problem that kind of turned me off of the King's Fall was when we were running it, we never ran it where we didn't have, like, a game-breaking glitch happen. And yep. I'll be honest, I haven't even been on Destiny recently, mostly because when the Rise of Iron came out, the RNG just tanked for me. And it got to actually being where I would play for, you know, a day or two and get actually less stuff than I was. So I was never progressing anywhere. And it was like, I'm like, I don't really, I mean, when a video game starts getting to a point where I'm like actually feeling like I'm putting my head against a grindstone, I kind of avoid that. Like that's kind of the antithesis of a video game for me. I mean, obviously I'm still 100% absorbed with like the story and all that. Like I absolutely love the story, but like the game mechanics actually is the thing that's kind of turned it up. But yeah, with King's Fall, that was the biggest thing. Story, the concept were as awesome. The mechanics? Like,
do you reckon like, it's because you always have that one player that has to carry everyone? Do you reckon it's that reason? Because everyone else is... You have one person getting the gaze. You have one person getting the relic. Oh, and everyone else is just on duties. Like, maybe that's why...
You're going off with King's Fall especially because it is very well. Sorry, with the raids in general, as far as I'm concerned, there needs to be someone at the top calling what needs to be done because people become complacent. They forget shit. Yeah. Like I'm not saying it has to be like an orders type thing, but like if you don't tell people to go to your bombs. 3, 2, 1, step in for Oryx per se for challenge mode, then people are going to be like, oh, yeah, whatever.
Oops. Yeah, like, they just become complacent. De facto leader. And I mean, that's when we run it, it's Sloth. He's, you know, he does it more than the rest of us. He's the man for us. And that's what makes it good. I guess for me, I think it's just too mechanic heavy and the mechanics are fiddly. Like, Wrath of the Machine still has mechanics, but they're just pick up a bomb, throw it. Or make sure you get to that place to be safe. Not everyone has to stand on a thing and then someone has to jump up a spiral and then drop a bomb onto something and then, you know, like, it's just too heavy and there's too much scope for, like, lag to play a factor or it to be ruined by a glitch and then you're like, oh, I've got to wipe, you know, like...
But even the mechanics and, like, Wrath are fun. Like, just thinking about the idea of throwing bombs. Like, that's cool. Like, you pick up the bomb and you peg it at the boss. Like... That was a cool mechanic, right? And
dodgeball.
Dodgeball. 5Ds of dodgeball.
If you can dodge a wrench, you can dodge a ball.
And Vossi can't dodge a wrench, man. But that's, I mean, I guess segueing into that from King's Fall, I mean, it sounds like we're all pretty unenthusiastic about it. Wrath of the Machine. I hadn't done that raid for a hell of a long time. Honestly, I did it probably when it first came out. I hit it really hard and then just it fell off the radar for me. I concentrated on PvP as I normally do. Doing that, I mean, we had our run on, was it Wednesday night, Sloth? We did the clan run.
Yeah, Wednesday night, yeah.
Man, that was, we had an absolute, like, roaring laugh of a time. Like, it was good. We didn't get hung up on anything for too long. No one really got frustrated. I mean, we hung a heap of shit on Tower because he fucked up once and we basically just refused to let him forget it. You know, he missed one platform once and he became the guy that, you've ruined the raid for everyone. Oh,
ruined it.
You know, that to me is like when the actual raid itself takes a like back seat to you and your mates having a great time, that's where I believe that it should be. Like,
yeah,
that
I agree, man. Like, I think that's where it's at.
And for us, I mean, Sloth like fell into that de facto leader role, right? 1, 2, 3, throw your bombs or, you know, who's got what, call out your things, whatever, you know, like reminding everyone to stay focused. And then beyond that, it becomes just a laugh. So for me, Wrath of the Machine this week was unreal. I got the exotic hand cannon, which I don't know if it's any good, but it's not all good. Yeah, but it's red and white, so that makes it great. Like
it looks better than the hand cannon from King's Fall. That just looks, you know, well.
Oh, that's Zauli's Bane. Oh, yeah. Would you like to go to see it some Zauli's? Yep, I don't know where I was going with that.
It sounds like something you'd put on a kebab.
I know where
you
were going, but it just didn't pay out for you.
Yeah, no, it's... Sloth, I'm going to rig up an alarm for next week. When Sloth loses the plot alarm and it's going, whoop, whoop, whoop. And just to keep... I'll be like the podcast caller, like you're the raid caller.
It honestly looks like you're staring into my soul. I don't know how you're doing it, but it's scaring me.
You should be scared.
So welcome anyone who's listening to this podcast. You're missing out on so much fun.
The gaze of the Sloth. A majestic creature. The Sloth will stare into your soul. We need to get Dark on and just make him put a picture of Attenborough and he can just do an Attenborough voice for a whole cast.
Speaking of which, just off topic, he did put up another Destiny, like that David Attenborough pish again. So I do need to watch it. I haven't watched it yet.
I was going to get a run in the if we do the content review anyway. So moving on. I don't know. I mean, that was my take on it. Did anyone else get anything particularly good or bad, or you know, not feel enthused about Wrath of the Machine? Yeah.
Well, look, I felt good because Sloth jumped in and helped on stream, and we won and done it in, well, not all of it. I have to close the stream down, but that was fun. That was really good.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was actually the quickest Vossic I've ever done. Yeah. The quickest Vossic I've ever seen. And that's that, like, on anywhere. That's not just, you know, that's not just shit that I've done on stream or Log's done on stream. That's the quickest Vossic I've ever seen. And that's from fucking, you know, you and your viewers that came in, Holy and Teabag.
Yeah, we did have a whole bunch of viewers in that too.
Hmm.
Toby, and then it was you, me, and Log, or Log, you and I, rather. So, like, that was quick. And it actually made me feel really well, really good that we won and done it. And we won and done it quickly. So,
yeah.
Can't argue that.
No way.
Honestly.
There was a lot of banter in chat too. Like, sometimes when I stream the raids, I think people are so excited just to have the laughs that they sort of switch off focusing on doing the raid. But that had a balance of talking crap and actually completing it, which is just like, to me, the pinnacle of like streaming a raid when everyone's like enjoying it. There's heaps of banter, but you actually get it done. And sometimes it can go the complete other way where people are just chit-chat and you're like, dude, pay attention. Yeah, exactly.
What kind of noises do you like? You're talking about paying attention, then Log and I are just like, nah, nah, we're just carrying on like pork chops.
We are pork chops. We are not halal. Right, moving on. This week at Bungie, we'll get straight into that because there's not really anything to talk about. I mean, we're still in the countdown for our gameplay reveal on the 18th or the 19th if you're Australian.
Less give yourself
an extra day. You know, like I'll have a child between now and then, but I'm completely ignoring that. That's not important to me at all. What's important to me is the gameplay reveal.
Can we play some bets right now of the amount of people that will be watching in the live stream?
Oh,
man. Let's play some bets.
I reckon it'll be over 200,000.
Easy. Oh, fuck, I reckon it'll be more than that, man. I reckon it'll be
over 200,000 easy.
I reckon it'll be double. What? I reckon it'll be up like 400. Yep.
Chat, you can place your bets too.
And we're talking about like
place your bets.
One of the most hyped games. Like, you think about how many people they get in. Oh, guess what? You get a few new fucking armor pieces. You know, this
what was right? That's what I was thinking. It's like how many viewers did they get for the
Age of Triumph?
What was the last? Was Age of Triumph the last one?
Yeah. The last Age of Triumph reveal stream, if I can remember correctly, it was over 150,000 people. Yeah,
dude, was it over 150? Because really? I know.
Go on.
That's a very specific number.
All right, 340,000.
357,291. Not one person more.
Do you know? You know what? Let's take a note of that, because if Captain gets that, my God, you are.
If he gets that, and he doesn't send me the lotto numbers by the end of the day, man, we're gonna have words.
Have to be on my desk, otherwise you're fired. You're sacked.
You're sacked from your non-paying role.
What were you saying, Blue? You were saying something, I think. Then you got shocked.
No,
by the
specific number. You know, like, I was saying, because I remember one of them was only like, I think it might have been the art stream, which was actually one of the most amazing streams I watched. But it was only like 50, wasn't? I think it was like 50 or 60,000. I mean, there was a lot of people, but it wasn't like anywhere near. Because I think Rise of Iron was a huge number. And then, yeah, I think Age of Triumph. I know it was over 100. I can't remember.
I reckon. I'm gonna call it. And this is me being typically outlandish and ridiculous, but I reckon it's gonna be over a million.
Dude,
I reckon there's gonna be over a million, because when you think about it, it's the first reveal of a brand, well, not a brand new IP, but a new iteration of a game that is fucking huge, man. Like, there was
8 million players or something with active players when Age of Triumph sort of came out, or even just more recent. I can't remember what the stats were. So you're saying 1 in 8 people would come and watch that stream, that's probably not too outlandish, to be honest.
I don't think so. I mean, and as much as they've been pushing the pre-orders and stuff, I wouldn't be surprised.
Is there a record on Twitch for the most concurrent viewers?
Yeah, I mean, probably. It was probably
held by
a live event.
It'd be held by like a League of Legends event or a Dota event or something like that. It'd be in the millions.
Or like a mouth breathing fucking ignore the camera streamer for, you know, one of those League of Legends. Just head down, mouth breathing.
It's like that World of Warcraft player from South Park. He's got the wrist guard on and the mouse, and he's sitting here like this going.
You did that alarmingly well.
Yeah. Well, I mean, they did base it after me. Wait.
Back in your WoW days. Yeah, fair enough.
We've talked about this before. 9,000 hours on WoW is nothing comparatively to some of the people who are still playing it. So
yeah,
relax.
I reckon I'm going to call it here too. Plus a million.
Go. PC crowd interested as well. Yeah. That is a really good point. Mm. PC crowd going to be interested. Yeah.
Will they be drawing new PC players or console players who have changed to PC?
I think it's going to be a combination.
Yeah, I think.
Because I know a lot of people are talking about picking it up. I know just within our chat, a lot of people were talking about picking it up on the console and the PC.
Yeah.
But I think it's going to be a good combination of it, which is actually really good if you think about it, because that kind of limits the influx of what a lot of people kind of view as a negative component, because sometimes that kind of gets a bad rep. And I know that with the people that we've been talking with, a lot of people were like, yeah, we're worried about this. And, you know, and it's like, I was just talking about this on one of our game streams the other night. And it's like, yeah, but the thing is like every single community leader in Destiny has been very aggressive in making sure that it's a positive community. Like they don't really put up with negativity at all.
No.
I'm sure there'll be teething problems, but
oh yeah, yeah. There's I mean, you always get that. I mean, just even if you didn't add PC, the influx of new console players trying to get the viewership bump for Destiny 2.
Yeah.
Well, even like big YouTube channels, like I saw like Ali A like upload Destiny content. And it was crazy. So, like, if you get, you know, you're going to get buy-in from some of those bigger channels that maybe haven't been part of the Destiny community, so to speak, but, you know, cover.
They'll jump in while the hype's there and make their money out of it and fuck off. I don't mean to be pessimistic, but they will. That's what they do. Like, you know, it's
not to name names, but there is a particular streamer out there who has made his point that he will come back to Destiny for PC. And same with that dude that you were talking about, Mylan. You know, like it's they'll come back, they'll make their money, they'll get a few followers here and there, maybe a few thousand subs, blah, 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 blah. And then they'll piss off to something else because all they want is the hype train. And that's them. They can do that. Let them do that.
Yeah.
The people will stay with Destiny.
That's a bit harsh. I get what you're saying, but you know their channels are. They cover everything, right? Like
I'm not saying it's a bad thing. I'm saying that's what they do. Those bigger channels that cover Destiny for X amount of time and then don't cover it again, they will do that, and it will bring a certain type of viewer, supporter, player of Destiny in. And just to tie in back to what you said, Jay, like the community leaders who have been with Destiny since the beginning and are still with Destiny, so you're talking your Gathalians, your Bromans, your bloody Snipertons, those guys, they will keep the community as is. But these dudes that are bigger, who can bring in like 10,000 people per stream, they will bring a certain type of viewer / player into the game, which then we as our Destiny players who play it every day or, you know, don't really stray from much in the way of content, we'll have to weed out those types of people again and either tell them to pull their heads in and this is a positive community or get the fuck out. honestly.
I think, honestly, the truth lies somewhere in the middle of all of that. I mean, you've got a massive YouTube channel. You've got a massive YouTube channel because you obviously appeal to a hell of a lot of people because you cover a lot of stuff. So,
yeah.
I mean, guys like Ali A and all that sort of stuff, they're kind of hamstrung by the fact that they're going to have to cover it because it is big and people want to hear about it.
Yeah.
But they're also going to, they're hamstrung in that they're going to have to move on because people aren't going to want to be continually hearing about it. So it is what it is. I don't think there's, you know, as for an influx of new people into the community, good, welcome. But there are, as long as the community values stay the same, I mean, I love this place. I love, you know, talking to, I mean, I have not met a negative person in the Destiny community yet. I mean, maybe one day we'll get a real shit sucker on the podcast, but it hasn't happened yet. So, you know, I mean, bring it, anything that's good for the game, you know, but, I mean, there are going to be teething problems and we're probably just all going to be aware of it. It comes with interest. It's like anything, man. You're always going to get some people who are just there for the wrong reasons, but it is what it is. The other thing this week at Bungie, Tefty Teft has the Bungie bounty this week, and it is tomorrow, the 22nd of April, on Xbox, 2 p.m. Pacific time. So if you're on the East Coast, he's in California, I believe. So you could probably... That's West Coast, isn't it? Never mind. You're on the East Coast of Australia.
Close enough.
Yeah, whatever. I'm bad at geography. But, you know, get on, kill him. He's a good dude, too. He likes Iron Maiden, so he wins pretty much all the votes from me. Yeah. One quick thing. And we kind of touch on this every week, much the same as we did about bringing old raids back. But, Blue, if you had the choice, would you like to see Destiny 2 have characters persist across platforms? Like, you could have... You had your characters linked to your account. Whether you played on, like, Xbox or PlayStation or PC, you could play with those characters. Would you like that?
In an ideal world, ignoring the pissing match between the two consoles, I think it'd be really cool. I think that would make a lot of people happy. I think the argument that against it's going to be that, you know, one of the consoles has exclusives for 12 months.
Well, they gray out like items now. I mean, there's like when you don't have access to something, say it's I'm trying to think of what the example was, but there are items that get grayed out. You just can't use them.
You would be if you were Xbox and you logged in and there's just item mocking you every time you turned on your Xbox. This says,
well, you're not going to get it
PlayStation only.
You're not going to get it to drop.
Well,
hey, on the Xbox,
at least we would see it, right? I mean, at least we'd see
it. At least you'd get the grimoire.
Right, I don't even know what I'm... I don't even know what I'm missing at this
point. You could
get
the grimoire. I mean, for me, I hope it does go that way. And that's one of those things where, like, I deliberately bring it up because it's something that I want to promote discussion about in our community. I'm sure there's a lot of other more influential people than me talking about it. But personally, I think that if we could do that, I'd go and buy a PlayStation like that. It's just the thing stopping me now.
I would be. I would probably be tempted to
have the time to go and level up another character and all that sort of shit.
My God, it's harsh, man. It's painful.
So what you want to do is similar to, I know we keep going back to this, but similar to a World of Warcraft type thing. So your account is here. So for me, my account is Deranged Sloth, and then character. But
link your
then
Xbox,
you can go,
links your PlayStation.
So it's just account-based instead of console-based,
yes,
is what you're saying.
Yes.
All right. Yeah. Let's delve into that a little bit, because you won't, like, obviously, like you said, Jay, there'll be the console pissing match and all that sort of thing.
Right.
And there'll be all that sort of bull crap. That being said, if it's account-based, wouldn't that open up, like, the community to everyone?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. And I think that's actually kind of what I'm really, that's one of the silver linings, I think, with the whole PC thing, because we already have it a little bit with, I mean, for the Xbox and the PC, especially with Windows 10, you know, the compatibility
between that, there's
already kind of there. And it kind of opens up the argument of, like, okay, well, now it's, you know, Xbox, and, you know, I don't know if they're going to, but they've kind of been slightly nudging Sony because they're like, well, see, we can do it. Why can't you?
Well,
and
I mean,
you have like Rocket League, is it, or right? Is it
Rocket League's cross-platform?
Yeah, it's Rocket League, yeah.
You can do
cross. There's a few others.
Paragon, I play a lot of Paragon at the moment, and that's on PlayStation and PC cross-platform. And you just have one Epic Games account and you make changes to your characters on PC, and that goes across to your PlayStation.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about, man.
The loot is shared. It's like having one.
Yeah, so you're not. So you wouldn't necessarily be playing cross. Like you wouldn't be playing on the same server necessarily.
They also have cross platform too.
Okay.
I think you
can have. Yeah. I don't want cross platform.
No, I don't want cross platform.
I don't think cross platform would. Because the controls that, I mean, like just even with PC to console, right? You know, PC gamer would have, I guess it depends on the personal opinions, but, you know, a lot of people would argue that PC gamers have a little bit of an edge there with the whole, with your hardware. You know, you can customize everything on a PC, whereas a controller, you know, a console, I'm like, I have an Elite controller, that's it. That's all
I can
customize.
You can use this on a PC, whereas on an Xbox or console, you're only using this.
Yeah,
so, I mean,
yeah,
exactly. And that being said, we've spoken about this before, like off stream log, with people using the Cronus Max to have keyboard and mouse on Xbox and PlayStation. And I think it's dumb, but a lot of people have sort of told me that the aim assist for the console translates into the Cronus Max into your mouse and keyboard, so it makes it a lot more difficult. If it was a PC, like PC optimized game, there's no aim assist, you're only relying on, you know, this, well, you can't even pull it up, the mouse, you know, like trying to play someone who has aim assist when you have none, it's going to be hard to implement across platform.
I see that as a thing for Destiny 3, maybe. I mean, I'm just worried about being able to access your players across platforms. I don't even see Xbox to PC cross-platform happening now.
Not cross-platform, but to have one account for PlayStation, Xbox, PC.
Exactly, Jay. Like that. Well, I mean, not so much for me. Jay's just put in the Skype chat. I want it for VR. I can't use VR because I get physically unwell when I use it.
Yeah,
but
I don't know. I want to be run at by a fucking doggo shark and just be like.
No, one of the first things when they did it wasn't the HoloLens, but it was another one of the lenses. Was they were sitting there and they're like, what if you could have the ship, like just being on the ship in Destiny on your VR screens. Like, you know, you're flying that hyperspace thing, and you're just like sitting in your ship. Like, you know, just it would. I was like, yep, I'd buy a VR set just for that, honestly.
There'd be a lot of people just sitting around smoking weed, just traveling from place to place and not really fighting anything.
Hey, well, we're a day late for that. Or, 2 days late. But, you know,
missed it.
We're going to put the VR on and we're just going to smoke, man. Yeah.
It'd be the Big Lebowski all over again, for fuck's sake.
Yeah, well, you know, whatever. All right, now, kind of excited about this little segment. We're gonna seg into Matt's little segment. If you want to give us a bit of an introduction, my dear friend, go ahead.
Yeah, I haven't thought of that yet, but I'll do it on the fly. We'll see what happens because I don't know what we're going to use it for. But what we're going to do is we're going to take some questions from my YouTube chat and also Twitter and do some lore explanation with Blue, and I'm sure Sloth and Log will jump in with some expert advice at certain points. I guess the point of this section is not the in-depth sort of lore explanation that you might get on my channel, but more about maybe more opinion-based and sort of examples that we want to talk about. So we have the first question from Night Warrior, who left a comment on YouTube saying, can a guardian live without a ghost? And had some upvotes, so I thought we'll have that conversation. Let's start with Log and Sloth. What are your initial thoughts? Let's start with that.
Here's my take. Without a ghost, you can continue to live, right? Your ghost resurrects you, and then the ghost dies. You're still resurrected. Like, you live. Yeah. But if you die, then obviously there's no resurrection. So I'm not, if that's the nature of the question, in that do you instantly fall into dust if your ghost dies? I don't think so. But yep. I think that's a good answer. That's my take.
Sloth?
once I'm going to tie it into log as well. Once you've been resurrected, you can live. If your ghost is had the light sucked out of it, you're no better than, you know,
Joe Blow down the street,
Frank Sinatra, who's cleaning the tower at the back there. You know, like, it's that sort of thing. If you get shot, yeah, mate, you're going to bleed out. That's all that's going to come. That's what's going to kind of come down to it. You know, yep. Like, you could suffer this typically horrific death that comes with Destiny Guardians. You think about it, it is a very horrific death, getting sung to death. Like, your head just explodes and your ghost can't bring you back. You think about it. Like,
oh, are you talking about the death singers? Yeah. Are you talking about death song?
You just die. So, yes, you can live without a ghost, but you're just going to be like...
You're not a guardian. You're just a bloke. No better
than this guy or, you know, this guy or...
Yeah.
All right.
I'll agree with that. Blue, what's your answer?
Well, the short answer is yes, you can live without a ghost. As far as, like, retaining power and stuff like that, I think that's... it can go either way. We have instances of, you know, you have like sun singers who have the ability to generate light somewhat independently. You can even argue that most guardians have the ability to generate light in and of themselves a bit. And that's actually we've had that argument a number of times over in Focus Fire. But the only distinction really is that. And you see this with Eris, actually. The only distinction is that when they die, you can't... It'll be their final death. Mm-hmm. And you see that with Ghost Fragment, the Queen... Or the Queen 2, I think it is?
Yep.
I think that's the one with Alderaan and Eris speaking about that.
Mm-hmm. That's probably the best card to give a sort of one-line answer to that is, we suspect it's Osiris, I believe, and Eris that are coming to see the Queen in the Reef, and Prince Aldrin's there. I think it's Prince Aldrin that makes the comment, you are without ghost or something like that, and Eris says, my next death will be my last. So totally can live without a ghost. However, like Log and Sloth, surprising the chat with dropping that knowledge. If you get killed again, it's game over. I agree with Blue. I think you have... When your ghost... I feel like your ghost activates something inside of you that gives you the powers to manipulate the light. And similar to Warlock's self-rezzing, I think there's a certain level of light manipulation that you could do without a ghost. You know, Eris has powers. They're probably more dark powers than anything else. But she still has stuff. And the Awoken are still have powers too. And they're not guardians. Not all the Awoken are guardians, especially the first fleet that went out there. And they were born in the light and the dark. So I think your ghost does change you to some extent to manipulate the light. You do need mostly your ghost to do that, but I think there are other sources of light that you can that you could potentially manipulate. But short answer is yes, you would still live. But having powers is probably another whole topic.
Yeah. I mean, personally, yeah. I see the ghost as like a conduit to the traveler, which is the light, right? So you take that connection away, you'd be inhibited at least.
Yes.
Maybe it's just a matter of amplifying what's already there in the person. The ghost there can sort of that out more. I don't know. We're going to find out because the traveler is trapped, remember, in Destiny 2. We're going to actually... We'll get there.
I was going to say, I would agree that the ghost augments that capacity. If you... I know Justin has a really... Justin is an electrician in real life, so he knows, he has like this huge thing where he actually explains this using electric currents. But you can also see this within Ghost Fragment. I think it's Thorn 2 or Thorn 3. Whenever Yor kills the bandits, you actually see this nod, because it's pretty safe to assume that these people are normal people that he's talking to during that scene. And he actually specifically calls out that they have a spark of light. And so if you actually look at light as kind of like an animating force within the universe, that actually makes a lot of sense. Every living being has light. It's just how much light. Yep. So it's like the force, right?
The midichlorians.
I wasn't going to go that far, but sure. Everyone has it. It's just, do you have the ability to manipulate it? And what capacity do you have? So the traveler isn't necessarily light, but the traveler has an abundance of light, and that's what the ghost allows us to be a conduit of.
Yes.
So we basically become a superconductor rather than just a normal.
Yeah. There's in the storm caller quest line, it says there is arc light inside. It says there's arc light, I think, inside of all of us. And a spark can bring it to life or can be like, you know, eliminate it essentially. So yeah, 100%. I think the traveler is likely our main source of light, definitely as a conduit between our ghost. But if the new subclass abilities that were added with taking King Right was, you know, you went to a lightning storm on Mars where the Vex were actually harnessing like arc light in the storm and you became a storm caller. You went to the Black Garden and pulled from the void. You also went to the Forge on Mercury, a place known for like solar energies closest to the sun, right? So, you know, there's other areas that we can pull light from, apart from the Traveler.
All right. Sloth's just stuck to the gents, but I mean, if you want to do another question, Matt, totally cool with it.
Yeah, I've got another question here. Cool. So this is from Show Your Stripes. Hey, Marlon, I have a question. I thought for Destiny 2, if the threat is in the last city, how are we going to have PvP? The Crucible was run in the tower in designated zones, but with the threat of the Red Legion, how was there going to be a Crucible then? What would you think the PvP would be if they decide to add it again?
Do you want me? Well, I'll go first.
I love think that question. I love that question, though, because it's so accurate, too. It's like, you guys just took away all our stuff, like all our stuff.
Yeah,
like
literally all everything. Of it.
Yeah.
I think.
Log, what's your initial reaction, Log, to that question?
Oh, I just want to say this. There's no PvP in Destiny 2. It's over.
Confirm. There's PvP in Destiny
2. We're just going to have to tell Sloth this when he sits back down. Get his earbuds in. Sloth, there is no PvP in Destiny 2.
Well.
Don't have to worry about that then. No, personally, I think they're going to justify it by basically they'll get us, we'll be in an outpost, and they'll be making people train against each other to, you know, strengthen soldiers. It's just the same premise. So, you know, you've got to be, you know, encourage infighting to train against, to fight against the darkness, or in this case, the Cabal. I doubt that we're going to. You know, there's going to be some real story-driven reason to, you know, we need to get back to this area to take control to be able to then be in the Crucible again. I don't think that'll be the case. I think it'll be, Shax will be there, he'll be out the back, and he'll have his own little tent set up or whatever, and he'll still be running the Crucible. Trials, Guardian, we need to fight against one another so that we can train to fight the Cabal, blah, blah, blah. That'll be about it. So, I don't think it'll change anything.
Sounds legit.
Blue. Thoughts, Blue?
I'm on board with so Focus Fire is hosting you, so we have a couple people who are chatting over there, and they're like, PvP permadeath, no ghosts. And I was like, yep, there you go, elimination on steroids. That's
elimination, man. You get one life.
It's what is it, Diablo hardcore mode? If you die in PvP, you're done. Just you're done.
And you then you can take all their loot. You can literally take their armor off their back.
Can you imagine the shotgun camping that'd be going on?
No one would move. There would be literally no one. Like everyone would start with a shotgun and go.
Where is everyone?
What is it? What's the no radar version on Destiny? Why am I blanking on that one? Inferno.
Yep.
Well, I remember one of the first Inferno games that I played was with shotguns, and that's literally what it was. No one moved. Everyone was crouched in a corner, and it was just like, it was the longest game ever.
Maybe that's it. Trials of Gary. We're calling it now. Trials of Gary. No res.
That's the noob mode, man.
Damn it, Gary.
Well, my thoughts on PvP Destiny 2 is that, so if you don't know, Lord Shax has a robot army called the Red Jacks, essentially.
Yes.
And they are the ones who secure PvP zones. They go in. On Hawks, I think. I want to say Hawks. Is that right, Blue?
What, they go like the end in of the Lord of the Rings.
Not those Hawks.
Oh, right.
No, that would be really
I'm
fun
like, dude,
too,
that, why isn't there a cutscene of that? Like a sweeper jack like horse. Riding a hawk. Man.
No. A ship called the Hawk.
Sorry.
Anyway, I'm pretty sure it's called Hawks. And they secure the Crucible Zone. So if you pick up any of the Crucible ghost fragments, it's often a conversation between either a leader of the Red Jacks or either a mechanic looking after the Red Jacks or something like that. And they pretty much secure the PvP maps for us to use. So my issue with Destiny 2 and PvP zones, which I think is why this question has been asked, is if we're so scattered, how do we secure these zones from enemies? Because all these zones are sort of enemy zones. I don't think they'll bother with an explanation, to be honest, for that. I think it will be like what Log said. We're going to have militia groups. We're trying to fight to regain our power or regain control of the city, etc. And that will be the reason for PvP training. But technically, I am interested in how we're going to secure a PvP map without, if the Red Jacks are going to be around, if Shax is going to be leading that still, etc.
Shax is still around. We saw him in the trailer.
I mean, yes, Shax is around. Shax is there, but I mean, maybe he's, you know, Warframes, whatever you want to call him, Red Jacks. I don't know.
What if we get to reclaim some of the PvP maps in the game?
Cool. You could do that. I'm happy with that.
That'd be very Halo Reach. So hey? There's so many maps in Halo Reach are like PvE maps, sort of, well, not PvE, but like story maps that you then go back and fight in. That would be cool.
Well, they sort of did that with the Gallahorn quest.
Yeah. Right, yeah.
But that was the wrong way around. We did
PvP and then went back there for story.
Yeah, we did PvP and then there was a whole bunch of Fallen there. So I was just like, yeah, sure, why not? Yeah. There's a Gallahorn.
There's a good reason to go back and clear those maps. But, you know, when people will be angry if there's not new maps as well. Like, you have to have...
Oh, there's going to be new maps.
What if it's like you help the Red Jacks claim new maps?
That would be cool.
Maybe a new game mode?
We know that Shaq... Yeah, kind of like that. But like... Horde mode. That would firefight. Because you have we know that Shax has some Titans that help the Red Jacks out.
Yes.
So.
Yes.
Yeah, because Titans.
What
card universally
is that? They crash through the roof. What card is that?
No, he threatens. He threatens Tex Mechanica. He threatens Tex Mechanica because they're trying to blackmail him. He's like, no.
No, do that again. I'm going to send Titans through your roof to murder you.
Yeah, but that's like, that's why I'm just going to go just to upset everyone for 1 minute. Give me 1 minute for a tangent. That threat doesn't work with any class other than a Titan. I'm going to send Warlocks. No one's like taking that seriously. You know what I mean?
They're going to pull you to death.
They're going to floof at you.
I'm glad this is at the end of the bit that we did for Mylan, because I don't really, you know, they're going to want to have edit. Yeah, they're not going to be instantly offended people. Anyway.
Yeah.
Nice. Triggered.
Well, I reckon that's great. That concludes our section with questions from chat. Always feel free to leave lore-based questions on YouTube. And if you upvote them and I see them, they can make it into the podcast. So thank you to those people who left those questions. Show your stripes. And there was one other who was the first one. Night Warrior, thank you for your questions.
Round of applause. Good job.
Good.
Right. Well, Blue, how much longer we got you for? Because it is
2 minutes. You get 2 minutes. Go.
2 minutes. Right. Have you seen any good piece of content around the internet that you like?
Anything
to do? Okay, yes, actually, we have. We have a video over in Focus. Actually, I'm gonna do a shameless plug for one of our content. We put together. So our co-host Justin, he absolutely hates, actually loves Snix. And so what we did was we made him watch the I think it was the BBC Planet Earth baby iguana versus snakes.
Oh God!
Have you guys seen this one?
Yeah, yeah.
So I have the clip of his reaction laid over the video, and it's pure gold. I'll tweet you guys a link to it.
Please do.
It's like pure gold, and it just his screams. oh, their music. So yeah, that's the snake video that Focus Fire everyone. It's the Focus Fire snake video.
Righto.
Yeah,
right. Yeah, check it out.
That's the running joke is if you hear me on another podcast, I'm telling everybody to send Justin saying 0516 over on Twitter. Send him snack gifts on Twitter.
there's a thing with podcast crews, hey? Like that's basically all the three of us do is just fuck with each other.
Yeah. Oh yeah. 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 Like that's totally what we do on Twitter. Don't step there. He's in chat. Don't do it.
Sorry, man. We're gonna have to do it. It's just gonna have to be done. All right, Blue. Well, if you're gonna go, we're gonna go to Focus Fire chat. We might hang out for a little bit and just take some questions from our chat. But thank you very much for joining us, man. It's been an absolute pleasure to talk to you. We'll definitely have to get you back on again. And it's been real, dude.
Definitely, definitely. And thank you, guys. We usually go live 10 p.m. Central on Fridays. That's actually where we are having to jump off to. But if you guys ever want, we also have game streams. I know everyone kind of does that, but we mix and match up. You can come make fun of me for not playing Destiny. Because I play a lot of SWAT and other random craziness in Halo custom games. But that's where we are all over on Twitch at Focus Fire Chat. So just Twitch, I think, what is it? twitch.tv/Focus Fire Chat.
Absolutely.
But thank you. Thank you for letting me join you guys. It's always a pleasure getting to meet and speak with, you know, other people in this amazing community. So we'll have to, both ways, we'll have to get you guys over on ours. So.
Yeah, well, I mean, when you have a special episode about dicks, I'll definitely be there.
Hey, you know what? Next King's Fall episode, we'll have an entire episode about the wall in King's Fall.
I'm your man.
Because, I mean, that's where it is, right?
Yep. I'm your man. Nice. You let me know, man.
Wall.
All right. You guys have a great, I guess, afternoon? Is it afternoon?
Yeah, it is.
You
it is. Are? It's 1 p.m. for me. I think it's still right. Morning for Matt.
We'll see you guys later.
Cheers, mate. Thank you very much.
Bye.
All right, well, Blue's dropped off, so I will change the chat to this. It'll fix itself in a minute. I think. No, it won't. Maybe not. Anyway, so if you're in the stream and you've got some questions, please feel free to ask them now. I've got a few from Twitter that are... sort of, we got a few that were a little bit more community-based than what we normally see. So, one from... Hang on, I'll just fix this up so that you're not looking at, like, half of Sloth's head. Though it kind of is an improvement.
I like how Blue's Skype profile, almost has, like, no beard.
Yeah, that was confusing. Then, I was instantly intimidated.
There is beard.
All right, I'm gonna need to fix that in a minute. But, okay, I'll read out a question and you can... look at half of... Just don't look at that top box, yeah? Okay, good. Okay. Sorry, I normally would have had this prepared, but I was distracted.
Removed warlocks. They need to remove warlocks.
All right, Dylan K. Jones wants to know, Matt, and this is probably more one for you than it is for Sloth and I. If we do meet Osiris in Destiny 2, which the... art seems to allude that we will. Do you think we will have missions based on traveling through time?
Oh, damn. I think there definitely could be. For those who've seen my Osiris video, I'm fairly certain that... Well, we know Osiris is obsessed with the Vex. I personally think that he has worked out how to time travel similar... Well, actually... in a different fashion than Exo Stranger. I think the Exo Stranger has a different method of time traveling, and I think Osiris has worked something out as well. You read all the parables of the Allspring, and he's basically preaching. It sounds like he's trying to become liquid and melt his body and soul, very similar to how the Vex are liquid. And so there might be a clue in that flowing through the river of time. So... it's pretty cool. I hadn't actually thought of that. I think that would be a really cool thing to do if we actually had to time travel to do some of the missions for Osiris. I don't know how that would work with the story, but it is definitely a cool idea. There was something else with Osiris. It's just left my mind. No, that'll do.
There we go. We turned that perfectly. Sloth's face is fixed, much to the displeasure of everyone watching. Righto. Why does Lakshmi get the only nice part of the tower as far as the vendors are concerned? Why is she in a lounge and everyone else is like standing around next to crates and shit?
Because she will murder your soul, man. She is one badass bitch.
She will destroy you.
People don't even know where she came from. Her mysterious appearance in the tower, people didn't know. Like, the Future War Cult is, in my opinion, the most powerful faction in the tower, without doubt.
I've done a bit of research on the lore of that lately. She's the lowest, like, number exo that we encounter in game, right? Indicating that she's probably only been reset once or twice.
She's only got a count of two, I think. Is it?
Does that imply that, like, she was? I mean, are we going to go into the whole, like, I mean, Cade was a person once. We sort of think that, yeah.
Yep.
So has she only just become an exo? So she's Lakshmi too. She was Lakshmi before that, the person. Is that the deal?
I don't know. We don't know how the counting exactly works. Like, if you're Lakshmi 1, does that mean you're an exo with a memory wipe of 1? Or do you not get Lakshmi 1? Do you just have Lakshmi 2, which is Lakshmi 1 was human, Lakshmi 2 was exo? I don't know. I think you would be exo first, and that's the number of mind wipes. Mind wipes.
Okay. Fair enough. I mean,
but there's not really much to go on. It's only in game that it actually says that. It's one of the. I think it's
the gunsmith. It's the gunsmith. Doesn't the gunsmith say something about
Banshee
it?
Banshee might say it.
Yeah.
Banshee. By the way, Banshee knows a ton of shit. Banshee actually says some really interesting stuff. Banshee, Lakshmi, and Cade Six are the dudes that probably remember the most about their previous lives, and Cade is the one that's really trying to work out the collapse. He's actually got some cool stuff in the. The collector's edition. He talks about witnessing the collapse, which is really cool.
All right, last question. Bloody Smack wrote us in. He's a regular follower, lovely bloke. His is more a community question. So he's basically saying that he reads a lot on the forums about how much more toxic LFGs become, sort of as, personally, I think it's probably as a function of things just winding down a bit. I mean, we're talking about every raid is back. Everyone's busting to want to get things done every week, combined with a lower player base, and people are probably a little less patient than they normally would be. So basically, he was saying that he'd encourage anyone to get out and join a clan and actually just try and organize these sort of runs with friends. So I wanted to just mirror that. If you're not in a clan, I'd encourage that you find one. That's how I know, or Sloth. I mean, I wouldn't know him without our clan. So... I don't know. I mean, have you guys experienced anything like that? Matt, have you, in the course of streaming, had anyone join that's been particularly impatient or anything like that? Have we been exposed to that? Personally, I haven't, but I mainly play with people that I know really well anyway, so...
No, we did have an issue with someone who was a bit drunk on stream one time, but that was the only thing, really. I haven't had too much toxicity, but I don't ever really go into LFG, so... Yeah. I just hear that. It's actually one of the things I'm secretly working on at the moment is another option to LFG it's sort to do with my mental health project that I've got going on. I don't have more information than that at the moment, but I think there could be some other solutions to LFG, and I know Sloth highly recommends the 100. What is it? It's just
.io.
The 100.io. They actually sort of comb through their. They seem to be like pretty tied in with the Sherpa squads and all that sort of thing, and they're also pretty good at combing their LFGs for people who are just like must have.
Yeah, you get rid of them.
Primary slot Galahorn.
Yeah, like it's, and unfortunately. This was what happens when they release new content for games like Destiny. It brings back all of the people who are armchair professionals.
Yeah.
For lack of a better term, armchair professionals. That all they want to do is just like, no, you have to use this weapon. You have to use this strategy. You have to do this. that's the thing about raids and playing with different people. Everyone has a different way of doing it.
Yeah.
Especially if you're a raid Sherpa. I'm not including myself in that. That's other people out there. You will watch the top raid Sherpas on the Destiny Twitch directory. They will adapt their style for the person who is playing with them.
Mm.
The really good ones will.
Mm.
You don't have to be a raid Sherpa to go through LFG or to go through the 100.io or anything like that. But it's always good to adapt to other people, because if you adapt to them, they may try and go, well, hang on, he's trying to do his best for me, so why don't I do my best for him? And then you will have a raid team that can actually coexist.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's ridiculous. And because of all these people who are coming back, and it's gonna go into Destiny 2 as well, unfortunately.
Oh, yeah.
And it's gonna be really, really bad. So, like Locke said, I would suggest...
I'd encourage you to be doing it now. I'd be doing it now because you're going to find people who are, like, us Destiny lifers, you know, like people who aren't, you know, we're going to be here. I mean, unless God, like, Destiny 2 is the shittest game ever, which it's not going to be. We're all going to be here. So, seriously, go out, join a clan, find a clan that's particularly active. I mean, pay attention when you're getting match made in games to the people's clan tags and find a clan that way, because at least you know that there'll be people to play with.
Yep.
I think we're going to wrap up there, boys. It's been a good episode. I mean,
fantastic.
We don't want to hang around for too long. I want to say, I hope you're not sick of Blue, though, because we're going to raid straight into Focus Fire Chat, because it was great guy, lovely to meet him. So if you're in the stream now and you want to show your support of what we do, we're going to do our traditional G'day raid. So just basically, once this kicks over, jump in and say G'day a lot, as much as you can, actually. I mean, even force it into sentences where it doesn't belong. I'd encourage that. Beyond that, you can catch us all on Twitter. You know, follow the podcast and all that sort of stuff. But, you know, support the community, and we'll see you same time next week.
I'll find you.
Oh, God, it makes me shiver every fucking time. Oh.